Hi, I'm Chuck Huber, and welcome to Stata Happy Hour. I know we're doing this in the morning again in U.S. time, but it is about 4:45, I believe, 4:47 in Edinburgh, Scotland, where our guest is joining us from today. I should begin by apologizing profusely for the delayed start. I had some technical issues with my laptop this morning, and sorry about that, Mark, and sorry to the audience. We're finally back online, so... So our guest today is Professor Mark Schaffer, who's professor of economics at Heriot-Watt University in Edinburgh, Scotland. It's going to take me a while to read all of his accolades here, so give me a moment. So Professor Schaffer graduated magna cum laude from Harvard and has degrees in economics from Stanford and the London School of Economics. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, the Royal Society of Arts, Manufactures, and Commerce, research fellow of the IZA Institute for Study of Labor in Bonn, and at the Center for Economic Policy Research in London. His fields of research include transitioning and emerging economies, labor markets, applied economics, economic history, quantitative criminology, and energy economics. The list might have been shorter if we just listed things you don't do instead of the things that you do. So welcome, Professor Schaffer. How are you today?
Thank you very much. I'm fine.
So, okay, we're finally on. I normally start with I heard we haven't gotten to chat like I normally do before we begin, but I hear you have a really cool story as to how you found your way into a career in economics. That's usually the question I start with. So.
I wouldn't say it's cool. It's a little bit unusual, sort of, and maybe a little entertaining.
Oh, good.
When I started as an undergraduate, I didn't really know what I wanted to do, and my first year I did I did a bunch of things. I did some math, I did chemistry, I did economics, history, and the economics course went really badly for me. I just didn't get it. I would do my problem sets with my roommate. We were in the same section, and he would get A's and I would get B's, and it was just immensely frustrating. So I promised myself that I'd never study economics again as an undergraduate, and I fulfilled my promise. I ended up doing my concentration was in something called social studies, which is an interdisciplinary major. I did international relations and social theory and history and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And my undergraduate dissertation was on a guy named Norman Angel, who wrote a book called The Great Illusion. You might have heard of it. It was an anti-war book published around Europe's Optical Illusion was the first. It was the short pamphlet that was 1909, and it was and then the full-blown book came after that, The Great Illusion, and that was about, he argued how war was economically irrational, and if only people would realize this, they would, you know, the specter of war that hung over Europe would disappear. And it was great polemics, but it was terrible economics. And I was at the end, I thought, hey, maybe this economic stuff is kind of interesting. And I happened to have an application form for the London School of Economics master's program. And I noticed that you could get a 1-year master's degree and they didn't require any prior economics study. And I thought, wow, 0 to 60 in 4 seconds. I can, well, let's do this. And that's, sure. And that's what I did. I mean, the first semester was real. Well, then in those days, the in the British system, there were exams only at the end. And so it didn't matter that the first term was just gibberish and I had no idea what was going on. It was just ideas flying over my head. I heard the phrase once, white noise, but I heard the guy had an accent and I heard it as wide noise. So in my notes, it says wide noise, but I caught up and passed. So that's how I got into economics.
Okay. And so your undergraduate was in social studies, you got into economics, and then you went on, you obviously enjoyed it and excelled enough to go on to do a PhD in economics.
Yes. Yeah. I got bitten by the bug.
Okay.
And initially I started a PhD at Stanford. So that's how I got the degree from Stanford. I passed the first year exams and so forth, but I had a change of heart about what I wanted to do my dissertation on. I was going to do something on technological change, And I changed my mind and I wanted to do something on Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union, which were then planned economies. And Stanford was not a good place for that, and London was. And I had also personal reasons to return to London. My wife might nudge me about that one. So I went. I left Stanford voluntarily, I might add, to start a PhD at LSE, which was partly on planned economies. This is the late 80s, and partly on it was evolutionary theory. There was some theoretical biology in there, actually. Mm-hmm. And I finished in 1990, which is, you know, just after the revolutions in Eastern Europe. So
I was going to ask how I looked through your CV and I noticed you have more than a few publications on the Russian economy. And how did that develop?
I got interested in these economies during my master's when I was at the LSE, and I thought it was just sort of kind of interesting. And then I realized when I started the PhD that I thought it was really interesting, and that's what I wanted to study. And they were marvelously dysfunctional economies. I mean, the analogy I used at the time was that if you were going to go into medicine, would you want to study routine diseases or would you want to go for the really bizarre ones? You know, And for me, it was a no-brainer. You know, you go for the ones that are really, really dysfunctional because they really were truly dysfunctional. Most of my PhD was on the planned economy, some empirical work on Poland, some theoretical work. And I more or less finished, I had it mostly finished by 1989. And my PhD supervisor was Stanisław Gomułka, who, after the Solidarity Revolution in August 1989 and the formation of the Solidarity Government, became one of the main advisors to Leszek Balcerowicz, who was the deputy prime minister and finance minister. He was on the Balcerowicz team. And so I started getting... That was sort of my way into policy via what was going on in Poland. I was in the last cohort of PhDs who studied socialist economies as they then were, and I was in the first cohort of people who were doing the transition from socialism and the emergence of market economies in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union.
Well, it was pretty interesting. I was going to say it must have been a really interesting time to be studying the Soviet economy in that era, because you were sort of witnessing history as it unfolded and studying history in real time.
Oh yeah, it was amazing. It was just fascinating. I don't think I had completed my PhD, and I was engaged to do a report for the European Commission on what was going on in Poland. Mm-hmm. And I found myself in January 1990 for a week wandering around in Warsaw, mm-hmm. interviewing people and talking to people. My Polish was pretty bad, but I could sort of get by, and just watching it all unfold. And they were just, it was just amazing to see. So I was staying in the Hotel Europejski, and you could walk from the Europejski to the Ministry of Finance and just like stroll in. And I remember one day during the week, I was strolling in, they had just had their price liberalization and prices were skyrocketing and nobody knew if the economy was collapsing. And I remember walking past, and just in front of the Ministry of Finance, there was this lorry and some guys were selling meat out of the back of a lorry at a market price. And I didn't have a camera, but this was an historic meat lorry, you know? I mean, it was just amazing. The market economy in operation, it's coming to life. It's actually not going to be a disaster. It was just fascinating. It was really fascinating.
Did you get to visit the Soviet Union at all? Or
oh yeah, no, well,
well I, Russia, I mean, or?
I visited the Soviet Union as a tourist in 1987, I think it was, with my wife and I traveled around. But then I did. Mm-hmm. I actually did some. I worked on the transition from socialism in Russia. And I got to visit I was on the First World Bank mission that after the collapse of the Soviet Union, that traveled outside of Moscow, and it was on a fact-finding mission. So we went to Chelyabinsk, and we went to Pskov in Western Russia. It was, and there were just some fascinating, bizarre episodes. Like we arrived in Pskov, and we were put up in this horrendous hotel. But it was the best they had. But it was really awful. The guy leading the World Bank mission, we found him in the lobby the next morning, and he was really annoyed. And he said, "We have to change hotels." And we said, "Paolo, this is the hotel. This is the hotel. We're not going anywhere."
Oh wow!
it's just wonderful stuff. Fascinating stuff.
So is that what developed your interest in the history of economics? Because while I was kind of researching you before this, and I found a video that you may not even remember on YouTube it was 2013, and it's a really good video. If you haven't seen it, go to YouTube, not you, but the audience, and search for a video called The Economics of the Very Long Run. It's a fascinating video of the history of economics. And is that how you sort of developed an interest in the history of economics? That was a really interesting video.
That's one of my two favorite lectures. I teach economic history, and I do 2 billion years of economic history. So I start with, I start with Homo erectus. That actually ties into the evolutionary biology stuff, but, I think it's because my undergraduate degree was this interdisciplinary social science degree, and I've just been interested in, humanity as an object of study, something like that. And so long run economic history, or the collapse of communism, or, the quantitative criminology, they're all fascinating to me just because I'm interested. I have this broad interest.
Sort of in human behavior in general.
Yes. So. Yeah. That's right. And that undergraduate degree that I did was interdisciplinary by its very nature. You had to do some economics. You had to do history. You had to do political science. You had to do philosophy. It was wonderful. Yeah. If you didn't know what you wanted to do, it was great because you could do everything.
You could just wander around and write.
Yeah. That's what I did. That's what I did.
Yeah. One of the things I found interesting in the video is where you talk about how do you measure economic variables over time, because there are things that exist now that didn't exist then. So how do you value an internet connection, 500 years ago when there was no internet?
Absolutely.
How do people do that? I was just curious if you could elaborate on that. I know this is an old video, so you may not remember any of that.
No. This is fundamental economics, really. It's a price index theory. How do I put it? It's very tricky. The simplest thing you can do is use prices from the end period rather than the start period. Uh-huh. So if the good existed, the goods exist now. We need to use constant prices. If we use prices for goods that, since all goods exist now, come on to that. It gives you an answer to the question, but it's going to undervalue the importance, the progress that we've made based on new goods. Mm-hmm. And so there are theoretical papers which try to address this. If you wanted to use like digital watches, you could use the price of a digital watch now, which is like really tiny, or you could go back. Do you remember the Pulsar?
Oh, yes.
It was like $800 or something that. You use that price and it looks like fantastic progress. We're all living in utopia. But if the good doesn't exist at all, you have to come up with something, and there are theoretical basis for doing that. But on the other hand, it's sort of related to my interest in the Soviet economy. The CIA used to try to value the Soviet GDP, and it didn't have market prices for this, and so it would try to get, so it would like one thing it would do would be to every now and then a Soviet pilot would leave, would leave the Soviet Union with his plane, and the plane would arrive, and they would dismantle it and then return all the parts, because you had to return all the parts, and they would get a U.S. military contractor to try to value the plane based on all the parts. But they were, and even in the, I'm not sure about the 80s, certainly in the 70s, they were still using radio tubes, and the U.S. was no longer making radio tubes. So when they valued the cost of manufacturing the plane, the radio tubes were really expensive.
Yeah, because you'd have to make a plant to manufacture
tubes. Yeah, you'd have to make the plant to make the radio tubes.
Right.
So you get, they were really expensive planes. They were, Soviet Union was spending an awful lot of money on these planes.
They basically cornered the market. A lot of guitar amps run on vacuum tubes. And the only place you could get them for a long time was Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union.
Right. Yeah.
So. Anyway, that is a fascinating talk. And we'll put a link in it on the YouTube video for this so people can watch it, because it's just fascinating. So the other question I usually ask is, how did you discover Stata? How did you come across Stata?
Oh, gosh.
You've been using Stata for a while now.
Yes. I can't remember, the first time I was exposed to it was, she was a classmate of mine, Alita Freeman, who's a wife of Richard Freeman, an economist, and they were both at LSE, and I don't recall exactly why I needed to do some empirical work, but she did a talk for the researchers at LSE, introducing them to Stata. This would have been the early 90s, I think.
Okay.
So I was first exposed to it there. I didn't do very much. I think there was a gap between when I got exposed to it and then when I started working with it, because I started working with it more a little bit after that. But that was my first exposure to it. She had a one-page cheat sheet on basic Stata commands. I probably still have it somewhere. And it was just really easy to see, because I studied some computer programming when I was an undergraduate. So coding and programming was familiar to me, and I saw the cheat sheet with the commands, and I thought, oh, I can do this.
Well, you obviously became good at it, because I went and checked, and if my count is correct, you've written or co-written 24 Stata commands in your career. Is my number accurate, or do you even know how many?
I don't know how many, and it also depends how you count them,
Well, that's true.
Because Kit Baum and Steve Stillman and I were pretty good about, this Ivy Reg 2, and, which is pretty popular, and we're pretty good about replication. So when we do a major upgrade, we archive the old version in a place where so it's just there and it doesn't change. So there's an Ivy Ridge 2.8 which will won't run on anything above Stata 8.
Okay.
How do you count Ivy Ridge 2.8 versus Ivy Ridge 2 versus Ivy Ridge 2.11 versus I don't know. I mean, but it's in a way, 24 is over how many years? God. It's not that much.
Maybe it's the years.
I'm not sure I should count the years, but I'm not averaging much more than 1 year.
Well, I was going to ask about, the other thing I looked up was last night I ran SSC Hot and did the top 12 most downloaded programs. And you are author or co-author of 4 of the top 12 downloaded programs in last night's list. All of them related to Ivy Ridge. So Ivy Ridge 2, Ivy Ridge 2.10, 2.8. So that's probably your most successful program. How did that come about? Was that just something you needed and you decided to write it on your own, or how did Ivy Ridge start?
It was something I'm trying to remember. I think I needed something. I think I needed a Sargon statistic. Mm-hmm. And this was not the old Stata Ivy Ridge. Didn't produce this automatically, and there was no post-estimation command and so forth. And I can't remember how, but I got in touch with Kit Baum and separately with Steve Stillman, and we thought about how to do this. And somehow, instead of just working out how to do it and leave it at that, we thought, oh, sod it. We should just write. No, it wasn't the Sargon statistic, because that was produced by. That there was an over ID command by Vince Wiggins and I think Kit Baum. And so we wanted some other kind of extension, and we thought, oh, SATA, we should just like write the command and make it available in general. Why not? You know, this is what, you know, good scientists do. You know, if you make a contribution to the community, you know, you make a contribution to the community, why not? It can't hurt. Sure. Maybe somebody will find it useful. Yeah. We certainly didn't go into it thinking let's become famous in very niche circles by writing this software. That was not the motivation.
and yet it's become sort of a claim to fame over the years.
Kind of. It's very peculiar. Because it's very gratifying to know that lots of people have found it useful. I think a fair number of those downloads are probably in students, because their teachers or professors are using it in teaching. Mm-hmm. But that's also very gratifying, you know.
Sure.
It's a nice thing, and I'm happy to have contributed in that way.
Yeah. Do you have any training in programming, or is this something you just picked up on your own, sort of for fun? Or
I did a course, two courses in computer programming when I was undergraduate. What I was doing, like, because I said I didn't know what I wanted to do, so I did some of everything. And so I did a course, and I did Introduction to Computer Programming, and then I did an intermediate level course in software engineering. This is 1980 thereabouts. So right. What counts is, and then I worked as a for a year, I took a year off in the middle of my undergraduate degree, and I worked as a programmer for a professor at Harvard. So got better at programming. So I have a kind of background in programming, and I know really, really old computer programming jokes, like really old computer programming jokes. Like how do you know that's an IBM repairman on the side of the road with a flat tire?
How?
He changes each tire one after the other until he works out which one's flat. See, now you get that.
I've never heard that one, but I give it. Yeah,
you get it. Yeah, because this is a reference to IBM mainframes and the IBM's. You know, they had a great this great service. Yeah, you mm-hmm. know, where you know the repairman would come along and just swap out the cards until the mainframe started working again, and it was really fast. And for IBM, it was pretty cheap. But well, I you know, at Harvard, Harvard was then digital deck, you know, digital land, and so they had IBM jokes.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just old enough to, in the 90s, I worked in clinical trials, and a lot of our legacy data was on a big VAX. And I don't know if those were considered mainframes or minis, but it took up a whole row. It was a big, it was like several washing machines put together. We actually used that thing. It was
Amazing. I coded on I learned assembly language on a PDP 11.
Oh wow!
That's, you might have heard. And actually, sitting here on my floor, I can even hold up and show it. I've got the keyboard to the probably the Mark, the Aiken IBM Mark II. The Aiken IBM Mark I is on display in half of it's on display at Aiken Computation Labs, I think, and the other half in the Smithsonian Institute. It was 1945. It was a programmable. It was an electromechanical computer, and has claimed to be one of the first. Programmable computers. And when they were throwing junk out of Aiken Computation Labs, and I spotted something familiar, and I rescued it. And I, it's not the original. Should I hold it up to the screen?
Sure, if you want to.
Why not? Let's see. Hang on a second. Here we go.
Oh wow.
That's the probably the Mark II keyboard, because you see there are two rows of numbers.
Yeah.
And you'd push in, you'd enter two rows of numbers, and then you press the button in the upper left hand corner.
Yeah.
And then it would print it out on paper tape, which would be as wide as like a piano roll, basically. And I think the Aiken IBM Mark I had only one row of numbers. Could only do one row of numbers. This did two row of numbers. Two rows of numbers.
That is so cool. I've never seen one of those.
There's the back of it.
Yeah.
It belongs in a museum. I should donate it to a museum, because they were throwing it out.
Yeah. Wow. Ugh. Yeah. So we have a couple of questions, and they're going to scroll down off my screen soon if I don't get to them quickly. So I'll start from the bottom first. Someone asks if you're familiar with logistic multi-level model, the logistic multi-level model, and how would you know if the Hausman specification test works for choosing between random and fixed effects?
Oh, Lordy.
That's kind of a technical question.
Yeah, it is. The Hausman test is very general, and mm-hmm. it's very appealing. It's a vector of contrast test mm-hmm. between two specifications, and it measures so it's one of the few specification tests that actually is in a metric that you can get your head around. Mm-hmm. Because you can actually look at the difference in the coefficients from the two estimators, mm-hmm. But you have to be able. I think the main requirement is that both of the estimators in principle have to be feasible. Mm-hmm. So if one of them isn't feasible, and I don't know about when you get into sometimes an estimator sounds like it should be feasible, but it isn't, like, you know, like fixed effects probe it or something like that. It sounds like it should be feasible, but it's actually really tricky. And off the top of my head, I don't know. It might be feasible, but I don't know.
Yeah, I'm just not sure either. Okay, let's move to something that's more of a fun question. So Javier asks, what was the first instrument you used with IV reg? Remember the first instrument you used?
God, I don't, but there's quite a good chance it was the weight variable in the auto data set.
Ah, okay.
Because I was debugging.
The omnipresent auto data set.
The omnipresent auto data set. So it was probably something like that.
Yeah. Okay. So let's see. What advice would you give to someone who's completing his PhD in organizational psychology but finds microeconomics and econometrics appealing, especially given if they have a lack of prerequisite economics background?
Wow. If you've got a it depends. The question is from someone who has a PhD in organizational sociology. Yes. It depends on how quantitative it is. Mm-hmm. If that PhD has a substantial component of quantitative training, then mm-hmm. it's feasible in principle to jump into economics at a moderately high level and just start learning it. It's possible. Mm-hmm. I had kind of this experience with theoretical biology. The theoretical biologist and evolutionary biologist, anyway, mm-hmm. they think about things in a very similar way to economists. And actually, that's not. There are good reasons for that. Mm-hmm. Darwin said he got the in his autobiography says explicitly that he got the inspiration for natural selection from Malthus. He was reading Malthus. Yes. And mm-hmm. and Wallace, who independently came up with natural selection, also said he got it from reading Malthus, an economist. Yeah. So the way they think about things is similar, and the mm-hmm. tools that they use are also similar. So it takes a while, but mm-hmm. it's possible to teach yourself. But if you don't have that quantitative training, so you don't have the toolbox, then it's hard, and you probably have to stick to an undergraduate economics textbook or something like that.
Yeah. So I have another quick question. I know we're running short on time, since we're way over time, actually, because I was so late. But I'm curious to know about LassoPack. That was an extraordinarily ambitious undertaking. What was the motivation for that, and how did that come about? And I believe I was going to check. And
yes.
I believe you may have the longest paper ever in the Stata Journal, but I think it's 52 pages. I checked last night. It's a very lengthy paper. So was a huge project. How did that come about, and how long did that take?
Oh, God. It took a couple of years at least. It arose out of a PhD student's dissertation work. Okay. My colleague, who's now he's now in Zurich, Achim Arendt. I saw this presentation by Viktor Chernozhukov and Chris Hansen at an NBR Summer Institute, I think, and where they talked about their methodology for basically selecting confounders and so forth. And it immediately struck me as, wow, this is really important. I showed it to Achim, who within 18 months later, he had a publication on applications of the lasso in spatial econometrics. He's very, very good. So we could see this is the direction that applied econometrics is going in. Machine learning and high dimensional data. This has to become a standard part of the toolbox. And at the time, there wasn't really anything in Stata, there were some packages in R and Python, but it's all very, I don't know, because the frontier is moving so fast, there's just lots of going on. We thought, well, we should bring this to the masses somehow. And it took a couple of years to really get it working properly.
Yeah,
I guess. But it was a good thing. I mean, I put a lot of time into it, but I'm glad that I did, because it's important stuff.
Oh, it is. Just an extraordinary contribution. So we have another question from I don't know if it's Facebook or Twitter or where, but it says, "Do you have any advice for big people who want to learn how to program, but don't have any background in programming. So I doubt you were trained to program in Stata. How did you learn how to program in Stata?"
How did I learn to program in Stata? Well, I taught myself, but that's because I had this background in computer programming. I learned to code in assembly language on a PDP 11. My group project was writing a Lisp interpreter. So, you know, I had decent skills, and so when you've learned a few languages, picking up the next one is not that hard. Now of course things have moved on a lot over the past 30 years, I'd require a fair amount of retooling if I were to try to do something professionally. You know what I mean? But the basic, I actually taught, I was a teaching assistant for a computer programming course for 3 summers. So I know something about how to teach it as well. There's lots of stuff online. And once you get your head around how to write a basic program, program in any language, with the classic line, "Hello world." Moving on to the next language is not that hard. So you just start with a friendly language that you know works for you and is easy to install and get going.
Great. Okay. Well, we've actually kept you way longer than we should have, so we better wrap up.
I don't mind.
Oh, well, but anyway, thank you so much for joining us today. And I apologize again for the late start. computer glitches. What can you do?
What is it? Yes. That's another old 1980 vintage joke. To err is human, but to screw things up completely requires a computer.
Yes. It certainly did it this morning. So anyway, I've been there. Yeah. Well, I learned an important lesson this morning. So anyway, thanks again. And hopefully we'll see you again soon.
Sure.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye.